Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air, but first, the daily contemplation. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior, totally transcended, expert in all dimensions, knower of all worlds, unsurpassable trainer of those who can be tamed, both teacher and guide of gods as well as of humans, blessed, exalted, awakened, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Perfectly formulated is this Buddha Dhamma, visible right here and now, immediately effective, timeless, inviting each and everyone to come and see for themselves, inspect, examine, and verify, leading each and everyone through progress towards perfection. Directly observable, experienceable, and realizable by each intelligence. Perfectly training is this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples. They are training the right way, the true way, the good way, the direct way. Therefore, to these eight kind of individuals, these four noble pairs deserve both gifts, self-sacrifice, offerings, hospitality, and reverential salutation, the joint palms. Since this noble Sangha community of the Buddha's noble disciples is an unsurpassable and indeed forever unsurpassed field of merit in this world, for this world, to honor, respect, support, uphold, and protect. Thank you. Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 47, recorded on the 2nd of December 2016 on planet Earth, in the forest, on the Nagas Mountain, in the central hill country of Sri Lanka, on a beautiful day, fairly hot, but with a light mountain breeze. There are four questions, one simile, but first the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. A simile this time, and all the Buddhists, they often use similes where they talk in images, because they say those with intelligence, they will be able to understand one aspect explained by a similar aspect. So they If you give people an aspect that is similar to them, today is foam and bubbles and banana trees and the like, then they can explain by generalization some other aspects or concepts that are not familiar to them. And so this is a simile of the foam, Phena in Pali. It's from the Samyutta Nikaya, number 22. Kanda Samyutta, the whole book or chapter in the Samyutta Nikaya, the collected discourses which you see here of the Buddha, which is a part of the Tipitaka, the sacred text of early Buddhism, then is number 95, Phena Sutta. And it goes approximately like this. It's one day Buddha is down at the Ganges River. And then he tells the monks, do you see this foam that is drifting by there on the surface of the Ganges River water? Yes, Venerable Sir, they say. Rupa, form, whether internal form, the body, or external form, the mountain, the stone, the walls, the planets, and so on. They are like foam. If one examines, scrutinizes, investigates them, all this foam, whether internal or external, then one will see that it is just like foam. It is hollow. It is empty. It is void of substantiality. There's no substance there. It's only a collection of bubbles that makes up this foam that appears to us, to consciousness, to experience, to perception, as if having substance, as if being substance, but it is actually only form, a frame of appearance, void of substance. It is hollow, empty. That's what he said about form, the first cluster of clinging, rupa, rupakanda. If we go into modern contemporary physics and then say atomism, if we say matter is made of atoms, then the atoms will have a nucleus. And if this is a nucleus, then the first electron will be 10 kilometers from here. That's the first orbit, and there are 8 orbits. And the last one will be something like 8,000 kilometers from here. So atoms, even though they have a core and some electrons orbiting the core, then they are made of 99.99999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999999 atomism says the same. The particle fever of contemporary physics says basically the same, that matter is mostly emptiness. And thereby, I mean really mostly, 99.9 and then 12 nines percent voidness, emptiness, hollowness. The other theory about matter is quantum mechanics. That will say that matter, if unobserved, is a cloud of probability. Probability is not material. It has no substance. It has no weight. It has no essence. It cannot be touched. So probability is also void of reality, of essence, of substance. Then he says, you see these bubbles floating down there, big bubbles bursting on the river. Yes, we know, sir. These bubbles, Vedana, is like feeling. Feeling is like bubbles. They arise and cease. That's just like bubbles are not existing on themselves, in and by themselves. It's only when you have water and you splash water, then you get a bubble. But inside the bubble is nothing. Nada. Nothing whatsoever. And as soon as the bubble is formed, it usually splashes, it's burst. So permanent bubbles does not exist. They're very transient, and so also with feelings. Whether pleasant feeling, painful feeling, or neutral feeling, they arise and cease again. They are conditioned by what? They're caused by what? They're caused by contact. Eye contact, ear contact, nose contact, tongue contact, skin contact, or mental contact with an object. As soon as there's this contact, passa, then feeling arises. It is momentary, it lasts only a moment. So it does not exist by itself. It is caused by contact. When the contact ceases, the feeling also ceases. And the contact ceases immediately. Right where it arises, the contact also ceases. Then there can be another moment of contact. So contact are like bubbles. Form, matter is like foam. Contact like bubbles. Then he said, perception or experience is like a mirage in the desert, shimmering in the heat. What you see over a hot road driving, for example, some shimmering. Or what the wanderer, very thirsty and suffering out in the desert, he sees this oasis shimmering in the past. But when you walk up and scrutinize, examine, analyze this mirage, then it's not there. It is only an appearance caused by this hot air that causes diffraction of the light. So he said perception is. It's shimmering in the heat. It is seen. But it's not really there. And this distorts perception into thinking. Just like the thirsty wanderer in the desert, he sees this oasis. What he thinks is an oasis. Then the perceiver, the experiencer, he thinks whatever he perceives, whatever he experiences, this is constant, this is lasting. I can keep it. It is therefore pleasure and happiness. It is me, mine, or myself. It is what I've made of. It is thereby attractive, alluring. It's not suffering. This makes sense if it were so. But when you go up and experience this mirage of perception, sanya, and see that it's just like the shimmering in the heat, then one can realize that this perception is distorted when it concludes by faulty evaluation that whatever is perceived out there or in here, past, present, or future, that is permanent happiness and self and substance. While the fact is the absolute reality, Paramatta Dhamma, the absolute states behind this mirage, these illusions, these appearances shimmering in the heat of experience. They are only impermanence, transience, passing by. And therefore, they cannot be lasting happiness. Therefore, they are ultimately speaking suffering. Therefore, they have no substance, no core, no essence, no self. So this was a cluster of clinging to form. He likened to foam. A cluster of clinging to feeling. He likened to bubbles. And the cluster of clinging to perception. He likened to clinging to a mirage. Then there's the cluster of clinging of mental construction, sankhara. These other three were passive influxes of information. Now sankhara, mental construction, intention, hoping, doing. There's active, some activeness there. And he likened this to a banana tree. I don't know whether you've seen a banana tree. I first saw it when I came here to Sri Lanka. It's like a man, he said, he walks out in the forest, he wants to cut some wood, hardwood, like this one. And then he cuts down a banana tree. And then he starts peeling off the banana tree. And a banana tree actually only is leaves. That is a sheath of leaves around a sheath of leaves, just like an onion. There's nothing inside. There's no core. There's no trunk, like a real forest tree. So mental construction is, Sankara, the Buddha said. It's like a banana tree. You peel it off, you peel it off, you peel off. You expect that there's something, a core inside, but there's no core inside. There's only peels. So when you peeled off the last peel, then there's nothing left. Nothing left. No happiness to be found there. No essence to be found there. No self to be found there. No substance to be found there. No reality to be found there. No lastingness to be found there. No constance to be found there. The last kanda or cluster of clinging is consciousness, vijnana. And he likened that to a trick that a magician, he conjures up. A magician or an illusionist, he makes a trick and it appears to be like that. But when you examine it closer, scrutinizes it, and maybe gets the magicians to explain to you how he makes the trick, then it appears to be completely otherwise than this appearance were. So consciousness, he said, was like a magician's trick. It produces appearances, illusions. Eventually it produces the illusion about itself, that it itself is real. And what it perceives, what is aware of this consciousness, is also real. But it's hollow of reality. Just like the trick of the magicians or the illusionist, it's an illusion. It's a hallucination. It's a fantasy. It's a phantasm. In India, they had an expression called manomaya. Maya means something that is made up. Mano means mind. It's mind made. It's made up by mind. So reality is made up by mind. It's manomaya. It's an imagination. A resemblance, a look-alike, is a look-alike of reality. But it is only an appearance of reality. The world is an experience of the world. The world we call physical, but the experience of the world is not physical, that's mental. It's manomaya. So what is out there cannot be said to be exclusively out there, independent of the mind that perceives it. Because the only access or witness or contact the mind has with the external reality is through experience and through consciousness, based on consciousness, basically. So a dreamed up I, me or ego, in a dreamed up world, cannot be absolute reality, obviously. It's not a dream either. It's not a complete illusion. So it straddles in between. To call it artificial would probably be good, because then artificial carries the connotation of that is something strange or not real or not genuine. And though this reality also, and that reality, it is perceived as genuine and real through this consciousness, then Buddha said it's like a trick. a magician's trick, which all people also, when they go in and pay money to see that magician's trick, then it's to be deliberately fooled. Because it look alike, it looks just alike reality, but that it is something else, not quite like that. This habitual taking for real, what is not really real in the sense of absolute reality, this habitual tendency leads consciousness into an illusion about itself and what it is and what it produces. And it is this habitual illusion of consciousness that is broken by awakening, which basically means waking up from the dream state, from the illusionary state, from the hallucinated state, habitually hallucinated state, which is the state of all non-enlightened beings, to various extent. So this naive reality view that there is a mind independent out there, that's independent of the mind that perceives it, it leads to self-deception, misapprehension, and thereby a false evaluation as lasting happiness, self substance and attractiveness. Thereby, it makes sense to run around in the world and to try to find happiness in it and try to make sense of it. It seems rational, but as the Buddha say, if you look carefully at it, then it's just a bunch of foam, bubbles, mirages, hollow banana trees, and tricks, and nothing more than that. In 22 minutes, this was the simile of the foam, the empty foam, the existential foam, which will be the title of this Dhamma on air number 47. Existential foam. Special Buddhist concept that more or less says it all. Question 154 goes like this. How can one be sure what is the true in any religion? It's kind of like, is there any spiritual security? Yes, there is, actually, but there's only one. And that is insisting to the absolute degree on direct personal own experience. Because if you have, instead of believing in a God, you make yourself divine, then you become the God yourself. Then you don't need to, obviously, ask anybody else whether God exists or not. Because you know with certainty that you exist yourself. So that's what Buddhism has in offer. It is to make all beings first divine, and then go even beyond any divine level. And in Buddhist cosmology, as we have been talking about before, there's 31 levels of existence. I made a video about this called the 31 levels of existence. And we are level 5, on a human level, on level 5. This means that there are 26 divine levels, and thereby, and above that, a level of awakening or enlightenment, Bodhi. So having had direct experience with any of these divine levels or with any degree of enlightenment, stream in 25%, one sweet terminal, Sakadagami, 50%, or 75% Anagami, or 100% the Arahant stage, then one doesn't need to have faith or blind belief in anything whatsoever. Then it's direct experience. This view the Buddha shares with a modern philosopher, the first psychologist called William James, which formed a philosophical school called radical empiricism. is radical because it insists on direct experience, non-intoxicated, not while taking drugs or booze or LSD or anything like that, with all six senses fully complete and in a sound state of mind. Then one can have direct experience with this phenomenon. Then one is a witness. If one can reproduce it, then one is a witness of this reality. Then there's no need for belief. There's no need for faith. Until one has this experience, then there is a need for belief and faith. But faith and belief always has this danger of blindness, because you cannot be sure. Whether somebody tells you it's in the Holy Scriptures, it still can be an illusion. It still can be a self-deception of the author, or of the God even. This God, this divine being, thinks this or that. But then later down the road, he or she or you finds out, it was not exactly like that. It was more like that, actually. So if one completes the Noble Eightfold Way and reaches Nibbana, at whatever stage one does that, from stream entrance to Nibbana, then there's no need to have any faith or any belief or any religion whatsoever. We say that the stream entrant, he is independent because he can reach enlightenment by himself or by herself, without books, without teacher, without anything. Because enough information has been assimilated into the mind to reach Nibbana by completion of the Noble Eightfold Way. So this intellectual independence is based on direct own personal experience. And this one should keep insisting on. The Buddhist invitation, ehi passiko, is not an invitation to come and believe. Come and believe me, or come and believe the text. It's ehi passiko means come and see for yourself. Come and experience it for yourself. Come and complete this Noble Eightfold Way for yourself. Then you're beyond belief. You're beyond religion, philosophy, science, anything, because you have direct experience. You don't need to ask anybody, agree with anybody, or disagree with anybody. Because you know, for sure, absolute knowledge, anya, direct experience. Insist on that. Then there is also a famous sutta, because somebody actually asked Buddha about this question, called the Kalama, was from a city, small village called Kalama. And they said that there come many philosophers and spiritual people wandering by here. And this will say this, and another one say that. And we don't know what to believe. How should we determine what is right and wrong among all these religions that existed in India at that time and still do today? It's a complete chaos of philosophical systems and spiritual directions and gurus and what have you. So it's very fertile soil for growing of philosophy, but also seen from outside, a chaos, a total cacophonic chaos of philosophical views. Nevertheless, so he said to the Kalamas like this, and it's from the Anguttarra Nikaya 365 Kalama Sutta, translated by Thanissaro Bhikkhu, American monk. So as I said, Kalamas, don't go by reports, by legends, by traditions, by scripture, by logical conjecture, by inference, by analogies, by agreeing through pondering's view, by probability, or by thought. This contemplative is our teacher. When you know for yourself that these qualities are unskillful, detrimental, bad, evil, these qualities, events or ways of behavior are blameworthy. These qualities or behavior is criticized by the wise. These properties or this form of behavior, when adopted and carried out, then they lead to harm and suffering. Then you should abandon them. Now, Kalamas, don't go by reports, by legends, by traditions, by scripture, by logical conjecture, by inference, by analogies, by agreement through pondering views, by probability or likeliness, or by the thought this contemplative is our teacher. When you know for yourself that these kinds of behavior are skillful, are clever, are advantageous, these forms of behavior are blameless, these forms of behavior are praised by the wise, these forms of behavior, when adopted and carried out, lead to the welfare and happiness of all beings, then you should enter and remain in them. So that was his, he referenced them to their own sound reasoning and then to what is praised by the wise. And what they have direct experiences of was harmful or not harmful, blameless or blameworthy. I hope this answered the questions about faith and the fragileness of belief. Question 156 is, what is the Abhidhamma in early Buddhism? The Abhidhamma is a higher science or higher philosophy. It's the last seven books of the Tipitaka, the three baskets of text. First is Vinaya, discipline. Middle one is Suttapitaka, which we just read out some of. And the last part is seven books of the Abhidhamma, which the Buddha, he thought out of the fourth week after his enlightenment, and later told to his mother, who had died in the Tabahimsa heaven, to a lot of gods, and then came down to Sariputta and reported every afternoon to him what he had said. He spoke it in 1 3-month long speech during one rain retreat where he spent in Tabahimsa heaven, and where his mother, who was one level higher to Siddha heaven, she came down to hear him. And because only devas can sit and hear a 3 months long speech without blinking and without missing attention, human beings cannot. Is these seven books, we can go through them. I'll just say briefly what it is, because it's a humongous subject. The last book is 6,000 pages, so of course I cannot cover any ground reasonably within such a short notice. But we can just go by, the first is the Dhammasangani. It's an enumeration of all phenomena into ultimate realities, Paramatta Dhamma. So what's the ultimate realities in Buddhism? They are enumerated there. Into 52 mental properties, Siddhasikas, 89 different kinds of consciousness, states of consciousness, cittas, 4 physical primary elements, the Mahabhutas, and 23 physical phenomena, and then the dimension of Nibbana. It has starts with the matrix, Amatika, which is a 22 three states classification, which classifies all phenomena into three states. They can be either state 1, 2, or 3. I'll give you the first three so you can kind of like get a touch of it or taste of it. First of the 22 three state classification in the matrix of the Dhammasangani, the enumeration of all phenomena, book of the Abhidhamma in early Buddhism. A, there are states that are karmically either 1, advantageous, 2, detrimental, or 3, neutral. State classification B, there are states or phenomena that are associated with either 1, pleasant feeling, 2, painful feeling, 3, neutral feeling. C, there are states of phenomena that are either 1, karmic causes, 2, karmic effects, or 3, neither karmic causes nor karmic effects. So you see, it's a cutting out in the cake, which is very clear cut, very well-defined three-state classifications. Advantageous, disadvantageous, neutral. Pleasant, painful, or indifferent feeling. Is it cause or effect, or is it neither cause nor effect? That's the first three. Then there's a second book is Vibhanga. It's a book of analysis. It takes everything apart. There's a lot of difference essays which explains different meditation methods and various kinds of subjects. Then there's Dhatukatta, it's discussion of the primary elements, what's foundational in early Buddhism, you can say. Then there's the Pukala Panatin, the concept of individuality, which is an explanation of different personality types you can have for various kinds of beings and how they come to be like that. You can say, if we should say it in Western psychology, is archetypes. And there's a lot of them, actually. Then there's a cut about the points of controversy, controversial issues, in philosophical issues that are discussed. The Yamaka, the book of pairs, the book of twins, with two states classification. And then the Patana, the book of relations, which explain the 24 conditional relations that can be between various states or various phenomena. Philosophically, early Buddhism has a message, and that is that you should use two method that goes each way in analyzing and a given phenomena. One first thing is cutting it up. That is like atomism, saying our matter is made of very small parts called atoms. And the atoms then we can cut up, they are made of out of neutrons and positrons and electrons. And then we take the positron, they are made of quarks, up, down, quarks, and gluons and muons and so on. So if you take it like that, this analyzing, this cutting phenomena up into smaller and smaller and smaller parts, then you end up with emptiness, obviously. Then there's another job, a little bit forgotten in our age, and that is to put all the parts again together again and say, what's the relation between all these parts? How do they interact? How do they, this part interact with that part, and that part with that part, and that part with that part, and what is the network of interactions, the conditional relations? And they are described in detail, in absolute detail, in this Patana. This is the Abhidhamma. There's no persons there, stories there. It's only enumerations or lists or matrices of various phenomena, how various phenomena is collected and connected, and how this network works, how the function of it is. So there's no person, names, or trees, or gardens, or heroes, or anything like that in the Abhidhamma. There's only ultimate realities, Paramatta Dhamma. There's no conventions, conventional truth, social conventions, Samujisatya, or any kind of cultural taints. Only what absolutely exists is spoken of in the Abhidhamma. We can go into it in detail later on if there come more questions, and we can touch more upon it. Question 157. What is the definition of mind? And what did Bhante mean in an earlier speech about ending the chain reaction? Yeah, mind from a Buddhist perspective is a cyclic sequence. It's a process. It's not an entity, not a static thing. It's a process that goes around from state to state. It starts with what? It starts with contact. One contacts a phenomena. From contact comes two things, arise two things simultaneously in parallel, namely feeling and perception. So contact causes feeling one, a perception one. Perception one says what it is. Ah, it's a tree. It's a car. It's a hat. And feeling, one says, is it pleasant, painful, or neutral? And thereby, it tells the individual what to do with it. And this means that the intention is for there. From feeling comes craving. Craving towards the object, that's intention. One wants the object, wants to suck it in. One feels that the object is attractive. One feels a need, a hope to get the object. Or if it's painful and one is unaware of it, then aversion. One wants to push the object away. There, hate, anger arise. So the intention is to get away from the object, to get rid of it. So contact induces feeling and perception. Feeling and perception makes intention. Intention then redirects attention. Where to go? Intention wants something. It intends something. Then it directs attention. Either to see something, hear something, smell something, taste something, touch something, or think something, or attain a particular mental state. Then when this attention is directed, then the senses impinge on a new object. For example, that object. Before, contact one was this object, tactile. I'm touching this trunk. Now, okay, attention, I seize this piece of paper. So it's a redirecting of attention. Then new feeling, new perception, new intention, and new attention arise. Redirection of attention. So these five things, contact, feeling, perception, intention, and attention, going around in a circle. So from contact one comes feeling and perception one, intention one, and attention one. Attention one then causes contact two, which causes feeling two, perception two, intention two, attention two, redirected attention to, which cause contact three, and so on. So it's a cyclic sequence that minds from one perception, moment of perception and feeling and intention, so to speak, is propelled automatically into the next one. And then the next one, and then the next one, and then the next one. So that's why it's a cyclic sequence. Let's keep going around, around, and around, as long as this intention is formed. This is basically the samsaric cyclic cycle. This happens billions of times per second, so it's very, very fast. But our mind has going around in this circle endlessly in samsara. So it has gone around there for billions of universal cycles, for billions of years. Has it cycled around in that cycle? Contact, feeling, perception, intention, attention. New contact, feeling, perception, intention, attention. New contact, feeling, perception, intention, attention, and so forth. So from contact comes feeling. From feeling comes craving. From craving comes clinging. Where can one break the cycle? What's the trick of enlightenment? Where to put the scissor in this cyclic sequence? Can you cut this link between contact and feeling or contact and perception? No. If there is contact, then there will also arise a moment of feeling and an emotion of perception. However, it is possible to cut the link between feeling and intention. Between feeling and craving, basically. So an arahat, if he has contact with a pleasurable object, so he has pleasant feeling, but this doesn't make him intend wanting the object. Why not? Because he knows his suffering. If he has contact with a painful object, then he doesn't want to get rid of it. Why? Because he knows it is impermanent. If he has a contact with a neutral object, he doesn't want to neglect it. He just keeps being aware of it. So he forms no intention from any kind of feeling. He's not caught up in his own emotions, producing new future existence by karmic imprinting. So it's between feeling and craving one can cut. And that's what I meant by stopping this cyclic sequence and thereby ending suffering. Because since this cycle, this mind manu cycle, this maniac cycle, is silenced, it ceases, then there's peace, subjectively felt as happiness. There's no new redirecting of attention, no new contact, no new perception, no new feeling, hunting or running away, running towards or running away from, liking and disliking. There's no caught up in that web of emotionally induced craving. I made a small Dhamma drop on my website. It's called What is Mind? And I will give the link below. What is Mind on whatbuddhasaid.net. The last question goes like this, is question 158. What is the difference between craving and clinging, and are there different ways to see and remove each? A craving is any wanting, non-wanting, liking, disliking, attraction, and aversion. Either you crave towards the object, then you want it. This is usually induced by pleasant feeling. Or one craves away from the object, not wanting it, diswanting it, anti-wanting it, being aversive towards it, trying to pushing it away, repulsing it. This is caused by painful feeling. And then there's this neutral feeling which causes neglect when one wants to have another object, namely looking for pleasure. One scans reality, perceived reality, and the appearances out there for something that can give pleasure. So these are the three things. So from context comes feeling. From feeling comes craving. From craving comes clinging. Clinging is thereby caused by craving. First you want it, and then you cling to it. You want the money, the happiness, the relationship, the sex, the pleasure. And then one clings to it. Or one not wants it, then one clings to being aversive towards it. Same process, actually. So clinging is caused by craving, and craving is caused by feeling. So they're very closely related. Clinging is a more tenacious, intensified, solidified, cementified form of craving that induces becoming of the next moment of the next life, that thereby induce birth, that thereby induce aging, decay, sickness, and death, and that thereby causes suffering. Here and now, and on all intermediate timescales, and from life to life, and from universe to universe. Same thing. So, what's the cure? If it's craving towards the object, subjectively experienced as lust, desire, wanting, hoping, longing for, basically greed, then the cure is disgust meditation, Asubha meditation, seeing the disgusting aspects in the same reality, in the body, seeing the internal organs instead of seeing the sexual attractiveness. seeing the disgusting aspects of food and of the world in general. Asubha meditation, disgust meditation. If the craving and clinging is craving and clinging away from the object, subjectively experienced as aversion, as repulsion, as anger, as irritation, as opposition, as stubbornness, and then is the cure is meditation on universal friendliness, on goodwill, infinite goodwill, towards all beings and towards all phenomena. So one kind of like, instead of seeing only one part of the aspect, then one goes to the opposite part of the aspect, thereby cutting it down, this habitual tendency to react emotionally in a certain way to certain phenomena, to certain objects. I hope this answers the questions about craving and clinging. Craving is, as identified by the Buddha, the prime cause of suffering, caused by ignorance, of course, of the Four Noble Truths. This ends Dhamma on air number 47. And as usual, I like to say thank you to the donors, and in particular, those who donated food here last time, which I just fished inside candy yesterday. So both me and the dogs and the cats and all the other animals who also enjoy our food scraps, we are very happy for your support. So thank you very much indeed. Remember to click subscribe down there. If you want to support or go to the website or have further information, then click the small eye hover with the mouse over up in this area. Then there'll be a small white eye coming, appearing, and you can drag down a drop-down menu of 5 items for support and further information. Thank you for your attention. And may you have indeed a nice day. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pampalela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed.